marginalized others out here were often the scapegoats for the problems the other communities saw in Wonder Valley, as though their poverty were a disease, communicable and infectious, making the feral families and degenerates vectors of ills to be shunned and avoided. This shunning in turn fueled a hamster wheel cycle of fear and isolation, and the coping through drinking and anger and rage. Sarah, it seemed to me, had fallen out of her community and found herself marginalized on the outside. This snubbing occurred subtly, though, slowly, without deliberate malice, as she became a liability, needy, a burden that fed the general anxiety in Wonder Valley, the broad disquiet, the unsettling sense that we were all just one misstep away from finding ourselves like her, mired in poverty, no way to bootstrap our way out of it. She was on a one-way trip, we all realized, a downward spiral from artist to other. This fear festered, a systemic neurosis, one not just isolated to Wonder Valley. The media and political rhetoric fed it so that many people I knew, both in and outside of the desert, lived with a deep, unending unease, myself included. What if my wife lost her job? What if she got injured or sick? Her mother had died of cancer in her early 50s, a very few years older than my wife was now. In addition to losing his wife of 30 years, my father-in-law also lost his home to the medical bills. And this sense of unease had gotten worse since the economic crash. A great uncertainty had pervaded, leaving people across America with a sense that should we fall, we may never get back up. Charity seemed in short supply too, as we worried those flailing others could drag us down with them. We retreated to our own, distrustful of those not like us, the country balkanizing to the point we lost any faith in our nation, our government, the media, exacerbating the sense that we were in this on our own. This stress was amplified further in Wonder Valley by its remoteness from the rest of society, the sheer distance in miles, as well as the cultural separation. So many people out here, artists, retirees, and especially the others, lacked reliably functioning cars. Fewer still had computers. The internet was expensive and slow, so that apart from limited broadcast television, many Wonder Valley residents lacked any regular, meaningful contact with the outside world. I've thought about this a lot. I've called Wonder Valley an island, a desert Galapagos, where it felt to me like a petri dish for the state of the country to come, a country on the verge of apocalypse. To me, Wonder Valley was a laboratory for America after the meltdown that seemed to loom imminent, where family and tribe and community would be all we could count on. To exacerbate things in Wonder Valley, newcomers have been spilling out here at an ever faster pace, changing the character of the valley, moving into the derelict cabins, fixing them up some, or just making do in others. And while many would tell you they came for the changing colors of the desert sunset or the limitless stars, most ended up here for the same reasons as those who came before them, because it was cheap. They'd say they came hedging bets against an imminent economic collapse, or just looking for a place to hunker down and wait for times to turn. They came longing for a sense of authenticity or an alternative to the American dream that had proved so nebulous and unattainable. They came searching for bedrock, the real deal, life and death and heat and grit, not the inescapable Hollywood renderings portrayed as reality. These newly arrived artists and retirees and downtrodden each found their tribes here, took to their own communities, limiting themselves to members of their own group, avoiding and even rejecting as invalid the lifestyles of the others. This created a dichotomy of cooperation and competition in Wonder Valley that fostered a unique, contradicting blend of social Darwinism and socialism, where the fittest thrived on the backs of the weak, yet anyone with anything to trade could get by. I thought of Sarah's proposition, her asking me to have an affair with her. Out of her depth and panicking, I think she recognized me as safe, as one of her own, and clutched for me like a life ring. A single woman, alone without family or tribe, Sarah, like so many women out here at their most vulnerable, had found herself reduced to an object, a commodity, allowed only one thing to offer in trade. But not only had she refused to allow this fact of her life, she struggled to accept it as a reality. Her melodramatic theories of moles and spies and G-men were an attempt to understand the situation that she found herself in, that as a woman broke and destitute in Wonder Valley, her vagina was the only barter she possessed. A few days after I saw Sarah last, her friend came and took her away. I visited later, visited her living in the mountains above LA. I needed to know how her story ended.